I've tried to understand it.
He will perform it!
Tonight, turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 1 through 4 is our text. And since Sunday night, we've been dealing with the subject of Pentecostalism, and we looked at its history, some of its doctrine. Last night, we looked at the subject of tongues. And tonight, we want to ask ourselves the question, why are people deluded by such things? And multitudes of people tonight are deluded by various false doctrines. And it's not an intellectual issue. It's not because they lack something intellectually. There are many brilliant people, intellectually brilliant people, that are deceived by these false sayings. In 2 Corinthians 11, verses 1 through 4, Paul gives a warning to the church at Corinth. Would to God you could bear with me a little in my folly. And indeed bear with me, for I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. For if he that cometh preacheth another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or if ye receive another spirit which ye have not received, or another gospel which ye have not accepted, ye might well bear with him. And he was warning them that there was the possibility that they could at least tolerate the false things that would come their way. And he mentions a false Christ and false spirits and false gospels. And so the Bible gives us many warnings like this, that there is a danger, a great danger, in our lives and in our churches of falling for the devil's traps. Why are people deluded by false things? And I have several points tonight, beginning with this. Number one, it's because they don't carefully test everything by the Bible alone. And we've considered this as these messages have proceeded, and this really gets at the heart of the whole issue in regard to the Pentecostal movement, whether we're going to depend on someone's experience, or whether we're going to depend on our feelings, or whether we're going to depend on our own thinking, or whether we're just going to depend upon the Word of God alone. In Proverbs 14, verse 15, look at this verse with me. Proverbs 14, verse 15. Now the Happy Hunters, Charles and Francis Hunter, are prominent Pentecostals, and they're basically retired now, just recently, but they have traveled all over the world teaching people supposedly how to heal. They claim that every Christian should be able to heal the sick and raise them up from their sicknesses. And they've had a very influential ministry through videos and through tapes and through their books. And Charles and Francis Hunter, this is what they say. Once you begin to walk in the supernatural, you really have to be ready for anything and everything and never question the way God does it. We always need to be completely open to the move of the Holy Spirit and never be so closed that we cannot see that God might possibly do something so fresh and new today. I have never criticized any ministry or work of God. That's a very foolish statement. It's a very unscriptural statement, and it is a very dangerous statement. It's a popular statement. It's a popular philosophy. I don't criticize anything. I just go with the flow. I just accept what God is doing. But how do we know what God is doing? When the Bible says that the devil pretends to be God, and he comes as an angel of light, and he comes as a wolf but clothed in sheep clothing, how do we know what God is doing? Proverbs 14, verse 15 gives us a loud warning in this regard. And it says, the simple believeth every word. She's a simple person by this definition. And see, just simple Christians today are those that just accept whatever they hear. They probably don't even take a Bible to church, and they just accept what they hear. And if it feels good to them, then they think it's right, and they go with it. And if the preacher is a charismatic personality, or they like his voice, or whatever, it's pleasing to them, they go with it, they think it's right. That's a simple person, according to the Bible. He believeth every word. But it says that the prudent man looketh well to his going. The Bible's not talking about simple, like simple-minded. It's talking about simple in the sense of gullible and not careful, not carefully testing things, not aware that there's spiritual dangers that he has to protect himself from. The prudent man, the wise man that the Proverbs, book of Proverbs talks about, looketh well to his going. He's very careful, and he tests everything. Now look with me at 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. The lost man, he cannot discern spiritual things. But he that is spiritual judgeth all things. Now that's the opposite of what we hear today on every hand. And they say if you're spiritual, you won't judge things. But the Word of God says if you're spiritual, you judge everything. The spiritual man judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. The spiritual man cannot be judged by other men, because unsaved men don't understand the spiritual man, and they judge him on the base, on the wrong basis. The world judges the spiritual man on the basis of its own philosophy and thinking, and they think he's a fool. But if the spiritual man is judged by the Word of God, then that's the only basis upon which you can judge a spiritual man properly, is the Word of God, because that's how the spiritual man lives. Well, how does the spiritual man judge? Verse 16, for who hath known the mind of the Lord? And they say, you're just judging everybody. You must think you're God. No, I don't think I'm God, but I think I have the Word of God. And therefore I judge things, not by my own foolish thinking. I don't have any better thoughts than anyone else. But I have the Word of God, and I know enough to understand that this is the authority, and this is what we test things by. The spiritual man knows that he has the mind of the Lord in this book, the Holy Scriptures, which are given by divine inspiration. And the chief problem and the chief reason why people, even in good Bible-believing Baptist churches, become deceived and are led astray by the devil is because they're careless and they don't carefully test everything by the Word of God. The average independent Baptist church, the people in that church, to my understanding, don't know how to go into a bookstore and look at those books and understand which books are dangerous, because they have not been taught properly, and they really don't care enough to be taught about it. And so there's an ignorance here of the Word of God, and then there's just this attitude of carelessness, as if there is not any spiritual danger, but in fact the spiritual danger is great today. And not testing everything by the Word of God, the Bible warns us again and again and again of these spiritual dangers and doctrines of devils and the devil taking the form of an angel of light. And I believe that's the first and foremost reason that people are deceived. Not testing everything by the Bible. What do you have to have before you can test anything by the Bible? You have to have a knowledge of the Bible. And I emphasize that, and I repeat, I focus on that, and I exhort about that, and I rebuke about that, because that's foundational. You can't test anything by the Bible unless first you know the Bible. And so we really, really, really need to be Bible people. The first reason people are deceived is that they don't test everything by the Bible and walk carefully through this life. And if they get a book, they just read it, and they don't know how to read it critically, and they don't know how to test it. They hear some preacher on the radio, and his voice sounds so smooth and sweet. I remember as a new Christian, and I didn't know what church to go to yet, and I was so ignorant that I even went into the public library looking for good Christian books. That's not the place to go. The book that I got there was a book by a Seventh-day Adventist. And he was teaching things, he was teaching lies and false doctrines that confused me. But also I was listening to the radio, and one man that I thought really sounded like a man of God was Herbert W. Armstrong. And he was a heretic of the heretics. But his voice sounded so right, so much like a good preacher's voice. And it just sounded right. We've got to learn how to test everything by the Word of God. The second reason I believe why so many people are deluded is because they dabble around with error. They dabble around with things that they know are wrong. But for some reason, they continue to dabble around with it. Charles and Frances Hunter, the Pentecostals. When Charles and I were married and we began to nibble around where the Holy Spirit was concerned, we saw those people with both hands raised. Whenever you begin to nibble, however, sooner or later you're going to get caught, and that's for sure. We began to hear a lot about a woman named Catherine Kuhlman. What was this peculiar, unscriptural thing that made her push them all down, slaying in the spirit? We rejected it, of course, but our hungry little spiritual piggy hearts drew us to one of her meetings the next morning, and Francis Hunter is speaking, stepped into the aisle. Catherine Kuhlman merely said, "Jesus, bless my sister," and bless me, he did. Faster than you can blink an eye, I was lying on my back on the floor of the First Presbyterian Church in my very best dress. All the arguments I previously had about the Pentecostal doctrines and speaking in tongues disappeared instantly. Well, then it must be of God. It must surely be of God. No, the devil can do things like that. In fact, nothing that she said is scriptural. If she heard a woman preaching, she should have thought and realized immediately that that's not where I need to be, because God forbids that woman to be preaching to men like that. Simple Bible truth would have protected her. When she saw people falling down on the floor, she should have known immediately, I don't need to be over there with them, because I don't read anything like that in the Scriptures. Jesus didn't fall down. The apostles didn't fall down. There's a falling down service in the New Testament churches that I read about. And she should have known, I'm not going over there. I'm not listening to them. I'm not reading their books. I'm not watching them on television. I'm not listening to them on the radio. I'm not going to their Bible studies, because the things they're doing are wrong and unscriptural. But what did she do? She felt it was wrong, but she continued to mess around with it, and she was caught by the devil. And she was indeed caught by the devil. This woman believes in that her husband teaches classes on the healing of baldness, but both of them are bald. They have taught that every person should be able to, every Christian can lay hands on the sick and heal them. And they had these healing crusades in various parts of the world, and that three times, I believe, they had to bring her back home in a wheelchair, and she's sick from a healing crusade. Do you see something wrong with that picture? There's deception there. The woman is deceived, obviously. How did she get into such a condition? By ignoring the warnings and ignoring the Word of God. And you can do that too. And I can do that too. It's not enough to know the Word of God, but when we see things that are wrong, we got to step back and step away from them. Mrs. Hunter is deceived today because she ignored the warnings of the Word of God and flirted with error and demonic delusion. And so, the second reason why multitudes are deceived is because they're confronted with something that they know in their heart is wrong, but they continue to mess around with it. Continue to read those books. I remember preaching one time in a church, and Independent Baptist Church in the 80s. And after the service, I went home with the pastor to eat. And while we were eating, the telephone rang. And after he talked on the phone for a few minutes, he came back to the table. He said, "You won't believe what just happened." And during the service, I had mentioned Jimmy Swaggart somehow. And this woman, his church member, called up the pastor and said, "Pastor, tonight I was convicted. I shouldn't be watching the man. I watch him all the time, but I love his music. Pastor, could I listen to him just one more time?" Can you imagine that? But that's what people do. "Well, I know he's teaching things that are wrong, but I like the music. I know that they're teaching things wrong, but it just kind of makes me feel warm and fuzzy when I listen to it." And they devil around with it, and they are become devoured by the devil because they're walking in disobedience. Thirdly, I believe the third reason why people are deluded by many types of false doctrines, is that they sincerely desire to be holy before the Lord. This is really one of the things that led up to the Pentecostal movement, in the 1800s, the holiness movement. And it was a movement centered on a desire to be holy before the Lord as God's people. And that's a proper desire. But it wasn't built upon the Scriptures and the sound teaching of the Word of God. And it was going beyond the Scripture and believing that God would give the believer, that God would give us a sinless perfection of some sort. Harry Ironside, I mentioned it last time as I was here, but Harry Ironside, the famous Bible commentator, when he was young, he was in the Salvation Army. And they taught him this doctrine of holiness, that you can be perfectly holy. And to be perfectly holy, you need to have a second experience after your salvation. And then you can be entirely sanctified and you won't have any problem with sin after that. And he desired that. He wanted that. So he went out. Finally, he went out into the woods and he prayed and he fasted and he sought God's face about this and he sought this experience as earnestly as he knew how to do it. And he felt like he had a powerful experience out there. And he thought that he had what he was seeking for, sinless perfectionism. And he went back to the Salvation Army meetings and stood up and testified, "Brethren, you need to rejoice with me. I've found it." But after a few days, he realized that something was wrong. It was back to the old thing. There was still a problem with sin there. There was still a temptation there. There was still a flesh there, a wickedness inside, an evil propensity there. And he got so discouraged about it that he ended up in a hospital with a complete breakdown. Why? Because of false doctrine. But he sincerely desired to be holy, which we should desire. And God says that we should be holy like he is holy. But when we look in the Bible and see what is biblical holiness, look with me at 1 Corinthians 1, verse 2. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 2. What is a holiness in the Bible? And there's two parts to it. And the first part is positional and the second part is practical. And we have to base our doctrine upon the clear teaching of the Word of God. And in 1 Corinthians 1, verse 2, Paul says, "Unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, both theirs and ours." Ours. Sanctified in Christ. That's the same word as holy. Holy in Christ. Holy in Christ. When I believe on Jesus Christ, before that, I'm a wretched sinner before God. That's how he looks upon me. All our righteousness is as filthy rags. Just a wretched, filthy, dirty sinner. But when I put my faith and trust in Jesus Christ, then in God's eyes, everything changes. And I am clothed in Christ, and I am in Christ, and so that God sees me not as an old, wicked, filthy sinner anymore, but he sees me as clothed in his own Son. Look at verse 30. "And that's my new standing, my new position. Of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption." We have all of that in Christ the moment we put our trust and faith in him. And that is an eternal position that God gives us in Christ. And it can't change and it will never change. And it doesn't change no matter what the believer does. What the believer does is important. How the believer lives is very important. The Bible says God desires us to live holy in this life. And that's an important thing. And if we don't live holy, if we're really saved, God's going to spank us and take us to the woodshed and discipline us. And there's consequences to sinning and living a careless Christian life. But if I'm really saved, I'm in Christ, and there's nothing that can change that. That's the complete holiness, the perfect holiness that we have. in verse 30, that's taught very clearly. And in the book of Ephesians, if you look with me there for a minute, that's the whole theme of Ephesians. And that's the natural division of the book of Ephesians, if you want to understand this important book, is that in chapters 1 through 3, we have the believer's position and standing in Christ described, and it's glorious. And then in chapters 4 through 6, we have the believer's walk in this world, and it's a whole different story. Because that depends on how I'm living today. In Ephesians 1, verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. And so if I'm in Christ, I've got all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. There's nothing I don't lack. We don't even begin to dream of what we have in Christ and what we are in Christ. We can't even begin to dream of it tonight. We don't even have that much understanding of it. But it's marvelous. And it's all in Christ. If I'm in Christ, I have everything. And that's the theme of chapters 1 through 3. In Christ, seated in heavenly places, in Christ. All spiritual blessings in Christ. And then when you come to chapter 4, the theme dramatically changes. In chapter 4, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. What is the vocation wherewith we're called? The vocation is to be saved in Christ and to have all of those eternal blessings in Christ. That's our calling. That's what we have, chapters 1 through 3. And so walk up to it. Live up to it. Walk according to it. And that's the theme of the rest of the book. Look at chapter 5, verse 8. In chapter 5, verse 8. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. We are light in the Lord. That's the position God has graciously put us in when we put our faith in Jesus Christ. We are light in the Lord. That's an established fact because of Christ. That doesn't change. That's eternal. Therefore, live like it, he says. Walk like it. Live like it. Live up to what you are in Christ. You're light, now be light. You are light, be light. And that's the theme, and that's the two aspects of our holiness. A positional aspect, a new standing in Christ that's eternal and unchanging and has nothing to do with me and what I do, not of works, lest any man should boast, but also a walk in this world, a daily living. And notice that it's described as a walking because it's a day-by-day thing. We can't be holy tomorrow. It's only today, day-by-day, day-by-day. We'll never be in God's will. We'll never be holy like God wants us to be 10 years from today unless every day between there we simply walk in what God wants us to do, in His will, in obeying Him. Do you see that? And there's a desire for holiness, and we should desire for holiness, and we don't desire holiness as much as we should, but we've got to establish our doctrine of holiness upon the Word of God and not seek after some false doctrine and some wildfire. Bible holiness is a walk and not a flight. What those in the Pentecostal charismatic movement want for the most part is something that will put them above the common struggles of the Christian life that's described in Romans chapter 8 as we looked at and other passages of the Word of God. Something that will put them above the struggles with sin that we have to face day by day and get them beyond all that and they can just fly along like Superman. And I wish it were true. But instead, it's a walk of faith. It's a walk of faith and it's a walk step by step. Walking along. And so I believe that the third reason why multitudes are deceived, especially in the Pentecostal charismatic realm, is that they have a sincere desire to be holy people, but they are not following the Word of God in that. And therefore the devil can trap them and take them into places that they should not be, because if we are disobedient, then the devil can
really can have us. The Bible says in 1 Peter 5, verse 8, be sober, be vigilant. For your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. So a believer can get himself into a position where the devil can devour him. The fourth reason that I believe that people fall into spiritual traps of the devil is because that they make unwise decisions in times of spiritual difficulties. Have you ever been in times of deep, dark spiritual difficulty and doubt? I have. And many people make foolish decisions when they get into those times, called in the Pilgrim's Progress the Slough of Despond. Randy Clark is one of the fathers of the so-called Toronto Blessing in Toronto, Ontario. And they said that a great revival broke out there in the 1990s and people began to laugh hysterically. And they began to roll around on the floor, roll through the hallways and stuff. And they began to sound out like lions and bray like donkeys and things. Obviously, it was a great revival. How could somebody get into the position where he accepts things like that as of God? Well, in his case, he tells us. He was the pastor of a church, and he, quote, felt empty, powerless, and so little anointed emotionally, spiritually, and physically. I knew I was burning out. Burning out's not in the Bible. But the devil can come with his lies, and he can say, well, you're not effective at all. You're a worthless thing. And in the ministry, you have no fruit at all. God doesn't even answer your sorry prayers. And there's times of doubt and despondency and discouragement that come. And in that position, he went to a Kenneth Hagin crusade. And he knew that Kenneth Hagin was a false teacher. But he went there anyway. He was so desperate for something, some kind of touch from God. Desperation. Another man in that Toronto Blessing, so-called, was Guy Chevrolet. And he was a Baptist pastor. And he said that he went to Toronto out of a sense of desperation. He said, I finally got so desperate that I was not going to be critical. And another man that is more famous than that, more well-known, is James Robinson. And when I was a young Christian, James Robinson was a bold Southern Baptist evangelist. And he preached against liberalism and was a very bold preacher. And yet, in his own book, his autobiography, he says that he just went into the depths of despair in his life. And he saw no way out. He just in the depths of despair. And in that condition, his wife advised him to invite a charismatic man in to lay hands on him. And when that man laid hands on him, he said that demons, multitudes of demons, were cast out of him. And he became a brand new preacher. And he doesn't preach against anything anymore. And he thinks the Pope is a great hero of the faith. What happens in times of spiritual despondency and black times? People make foolish decisions. There's a very good saying that's helped me a lot in my Christian life. It's not in the Bible exactly, but it's based upon many truths of the Bible. Don't doubt in the dark that which God has shown you in the light. That's an important truth. No matter how desperate you get, do not ignore the Word of God and your conscience. Do not break down the walls of biblical separation that God has commanded that we erect against doctrinal error. To do so is to invite spiritual delusion. God has not promised that the Christian life will be smooth sailing. Will you look with me at Psalm 119 tonight? God has not promised that the Christian life will be smooth sailing. In fact, He's promised that it will be filled with every sort of trial and difficulty. In fact, we have the same trials that unsaved people face, plus a lot more in many ways. Of course, we have blessings they do not have. But when it comes to trials, we have more than they have. And Psalm 119 is the record of the man of God who loves the Word of God. And it's the longest chapter in the Bible, longest psalm in the Bible. And every verse is about the Word of God and the man of God and his love for the Word of God. But it is filled with descriptions of the trials that he was facing. Look at verse 25, for example. Psalm 119, verse 25. My soul cleaveth unto the dust. Well, that's not a good place for your soul to be. Dragging along on the ground, just as down as you can get. Talk about depression. He's depressed. He's disgraced. His soul is way down there. Quicken thou me according to thy word, Lord. But look at verse 81. My soul fainteth for thy salvation. Why? Because it hasn't come. Because I don't see it anywhere. Because I've been crying out a long time and there's no salvation come yet. So I'm still looking for it. And my soul is fainting because it doesn't look like it's going to come. You ever been there? Mine eyes fail for thy word, saying, when wilt thou comfort me? Why would you say that? You say that because you don't have any comfort at that time. And it doesn't seem like God is going to comfort you. Notice verse 83. For I am become like a bottle in the smoke. Well, now that's talking about a leather bottle. And a leather bottle, you put that in the smoke, and what? It just, all the moisture's gone, and it's just dry. He said, my soul's like that. I'm like that. It just seems like there's nothing, there's no spirituality, no life, no, nothing there. I felt like that many times. And he says, yet I do not forget thy statutes. He said, I don't forget thy word, but look at me, Lord. Look at my condition. Look at verse 92. Unless thy law had been my delights, I should then have perished in mine affliction. That's pretty bad affliction. Look with me at verse 107. I'm afflicted very much. He's talking to the Lord. I'm afflicted very much. Quicken me, O Lord, according to thy word. Look at verse 109. My soul is continually in my hand. And he's talking about the despondent, the seemingly hopeless condition that he's in at this present time. Look at verse 123. Mine eyes fail for thy salvation. Why? Because it hasn't come. Look at verse 143. 143, the righteous, trouble and anguish have taken hold on me. Trouble and anguish. Yet, thy commandments are my delights. Now you see, we get puzzled when trouble comes. We think it's a strange thing. Why me, Lord? What's this going on here? What's this all about? Not only has I got trials without, but I got trials within. I got the dead dryness of soul. Don't I have the Holy Spirit? What's going on here? And I remember talking to a pastor that I had have a great respect for in Texas. And he was the kind of man that when he preached through a certain book of the Bible, he would memorize that whole book. And a mighty man of prayer. And I came to visit him one time and sat across from his desk and he said to me, you know, he said, David, the Bible mocks me today. The Bible mocks me these days. He said, I read it and I continue to read it and I can't stop reading it, but it doesn't speak to me at all anymore. And in his case, it was a physical condition. He had a heart collapse, kidney collapse. But things happen. And God doesn't promise this Superman sailing above it all thing. That's not what the Word of God promises. So we should not be puzzled. These things come, we just continue to walk in the Word of God. We just continue to believe God. We just continue to read His Word. And we just walk through it and it passes away. Because God is faithful, but we have to walk through these trials. And so people make foolish decisions in the midst of times of deep trials. And they go running over here where they shouldn't run, looking for a little help. When it's right here, it's right here, but it takes patience. We got to just continue walking. Continue walking through that trial. This is the normal Christian life. It is a walk of faith, not sight. So don't allow the devil to promise you a quick path to perfection that will be experienced only when Jesus comes or we're taken out of this wicked world at the rapture. Let me mention a fifth reason that I believe people become caught up in these false things. And that is that they lean upon fallible men instead of the infallible Bible. They lean upon men. You might be leaning upon men tonight. If you don't know the Word of God very well, you are. Because you have no way in the world to really test these things and know whether I'm speaking the truth or the pastor's speaking the truth or somebody else is. Because how can you test it? You're leaning on a man. And if men change, you know, many times when pastors fail, people just quit church. Why? They were leaning on a man. Our eyes should never be on a man. We need men. God says we need men. And He gives men to the church as gifted men. But our eyes should never be on those men. Our eyes must be on Christ and on the Word of God. Look with me at 1 John 2:27. This is very important to understand and get right. In 1 John 2:27, and only God knows our hearts and who we're really trusting in. In 1 John 2:27, 1 John 2:27 says we don't need a teacher. But the anointing which ye have received of Him abideth in you, and ye need not that any man teach you. Need not that any man teach you. But as the same anointing teacheth you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it hath taught you, ye shall abide in Him. It says you need not that any man teach you. So what does that mean? Well, it could be contradictory to other things in the Bible, such as obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves. And look with me, keep your finger there, but look at another verse in Ephesians 4. In Ephesians 4, verse 11. Ephesians 4, verse 11. Seems to be contradictory. In Ephesians 4, verse 11, 1 John 2:27 says, you need not that any man teach you. And here, in Ephesians 4, 11, He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. And so this verse, this passage says, God has given men to the churches to protect us from the devil and to build us up and present us strong in Christ. But 1 John 2:27 says, you need not that any man teach you. What's the difference? No contradictions in the Bible. Context explains the difference. He's talking about the Holy Spirit. You don't need any man to take the Holy Spirit's place in your life. That's what he's saying. And my friends, there are independent Baptist churches tonight where the pastor seemingly wants to be the Holy Spirit in people's lives, but that is blasphemy because there's only one God, and if any man tries to take the place of God in people's lives, that's idolatry. But you know why that happens? Because people let it happen. Because they want that to be happen. Let the pastor make the decision. Let him study the Bible. Let him worry about the false teachers. Let him do that. I'll go about my business. And they willingly let some man rule over them and let some man become the Holy Spirit in their lives. That's a serious business. Leaning on fallible men instead of the infallible Bible. I praise the Lord for gifted men that have edified me and have taught me the Bible and have given me a wisdom in my Christian life and understanding. Men have done that. godly men, but I'm not dependent on them at the end of the day. I have the Holy Spirit, and I can test them, and I have the Bible, and I can test them. And not one of them is infallible. No man is infallible. People name their heroes and as if that's the end of the story. You don't believe in Calvinism, Brother Cloud, but what about Charles Spurgeon? Well, I respect Charles Spurgeon, and I thank the Lord for the things I've learned from him, but he's not Almighty God. He's not the Holy Spirit. He's not the Bible. Well, what about Jack House or whoever it is? What about? He's just a man, and we're supposed to test him by the Word of God like any other man. This is serious. Leaning on fallible men instead of the infallible Bible. Chip Brogan, a follower of Benny Hinn, who left it after a while, praise the Lord. But he talks about how that happened in his life, what happened, what went wrong. He said, as a young Christian, it wasn't long before my library contained books written by Kenneth Hagin and Kenneth Copeland and Jerry Saville and Lester Summerall, Charles Capps, and other leading word faith teachers. And he just threw himself at the feet of these men as if they're God and just filled his life with their teaching. And it was wrong. It was false teaching. And if he had had an open Bible there like he should have, putting more time into the Bible than into these men, he would have known that they were wrong. There's two passages in the book of John that are very important. Look with me at John 7, 17. John chapter 7 and John chapter 8. John 7, 17. And the man that led me to Christ told me these two passages. John 7, 17. If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. Jesus said you can know true doctrine from false, but you got to be willing to do what the preacher says. Not the preacher, what the Word of God says. You've got to be willing to do what the Word of God says. Many are not. Many are not. And then John 8, verse 31. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And so you've got to continue in the word, and then you've got to obey the word as God teaches it to you. And then you can know the truth. And too many trust in man rather than God. Put their faith in some preacher rather than the Spirit of God and the Word of God. Let me mention another reason. And that is leaning on experiences rather than strictly living by faith in God's Word. We've dealt with this, but this is the chief error of the charismatic Pentecostal movement. Putting experience above the Word of God. Experience above the Word of God. Listen to this thing that happened in Charles Parham's life. Charles Parham was one of the fathers of Pentecostalism, and he taught all sorts of heresies. And one of his heresies is that you can experience sinless perfectionism, that sanctification can be perfect and you need to have a second baptism. And there was another preacher in that day named William Durham, and he taught that Parham's doctrine is heresy. The Bible teaches that we're perfect in Christ, but that we have to grow, and the Christian living is a matter of growing. Practical sanctification is a matter of growing, walking, growing. It's not some experience whereby you achieve perfectionism. That's what the Bible teaches. William Durham was teaching the Bible doctrine. Charles Parham was teaching heresy. And Parham made this challenge. He was a very brash man. He said, if this man's doctrine is true, let my life go out to prove it. Let me die. But if my teaching on the definite grace of sanctification is true, let him die. Do you know who died? The Bible teacher died. The sound Bible teacher died. You know what that means? Nothing.
Everybody dies. Just happened to die at that time. It means nothing. The Bible's everything. The Bible says that man was right. The man that died, that challenge was nothing, meant nothing. Yet multitudes would see that. Well, his teaching must have been wrong. No, no matter what happens, the Bible's right, and nothing else matters. Nothing else. I remember before I was saved, I liked to throw out fleeces. I learned that in Sunday school. It's the only thing I learned. And I was riding down the road with this man that led me to the Lord, but at the time I was arguing with him and disputing the Bible. I didn't like the Bible. And so I became confused. This man's teaching the Bible, and I don't believe the Bible. And I say, God, I can't figure this out. I don't know if the Bible's right or if I'm right. And so I said, Lord, it was something like this. We were going around a curve. There was a curve up here down the road, and there were telephone poles along the road. And I said, God, if this man's right, let there be a bird on the second telephone pole after we go after the curve. That's pretty simple. God can do that. Just do that. And then it'll be settled, and I won't have to worry about it. The Bible's true. I'm true. My religion's true. My Hinduism's true. Guess what? There was no bird. What did it mean? Nothing. It meant nothing. The Bible's true. Bird or no bird. Look, this is what happens to people. These are the things that happen to people. People like you and me. The only thing that determines God's will, the only thing, is the Bible. Period. And so we're living in desperate times when the largest movement in Christianity today is Pentecostal Charismatic Movement, sweeping through the Roman Catholic Church. It's a time to be very careful. It's a time to be build our lives upon the Word of God. It's a time to be in a strong church, to raise our families in a strong church, and to raise our families in the Word of God. Our children need to be strong in the Word of God. Now, in conclusion, look with me at Ephesians 5:18. Ephesians 5:18, the Bible tells us how to have spiritual revival. People read revival books, and they say, well, we need to have that happen here. Well, we do. We do need spiritual revival, but we don't need to read a revival book for that. We don't even need to have strange things happen. Ephesians 5:18, and be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. That's spiritual revival. What's that mean? Walking in the Spirit, submitting to the Spirit, surrendering to the Spirit, and obeying the Spirit. Day by day, walking along in obedience to the Holy Spirit. When I know that this is what I'm supposed to do, that's what I do. That's spiritual revival. That's just filling with the Holy Spirit. It's not falling down on the floor and foaming at the mouth. It's walking in submission to the Holy Spirit through His Word. God bless you, Pastor.